boys and girls. Tell your family, tell your friends. You guys got to see Paul McGillion. Everybody cheer, come on!
Oh my God, I'm nervous. Look at all you people. Does this come out?
Yeah, a little bit.
That's what she said. Thank you! How you guys doing? Thank you so much for having me here. It's 6:30, it's a late panel, but I'm thrilled to be here. And you're a very, very sexy group, so thank you very, very much.
Okay, so here's how it's going to work, folks. Let's get this thing back on track. I'm going to do about 20 minutes of questions, learn all about Paul, all his deep, dark secrets, do a little couples therapy up here, and then I'm going to turn over to you guys for all your hard-hitting expose 60-minute style questions, and that's how it's going to work. Then we're going to get out of here and go drink. Ready? All right.
I love this guy.
First question, I think probably this is on everyone's mind right off the bat.
I'm married.
Yeah, too late. Yeah, we already asked and answered. Stargate Extinction. What do you know in terms of MGM dying? It's never coming back. Is it coming back? Can you give us any hope that there will be a Stargate movie, Stargate Atlantis movie? Go.
I would love to. All I know as far as Joe Malazzi, Paul Molly, they wrote a script after season 5 of Stargate Atlantis. I know it's finished. I know all the main cast were in the script. Whether they pull the trigger on that and do it is still a mystery. But I would certainly love to do it at some point. Tom, would you guys like to see something like that? Yeah. You know, it's amazing. You know, you travel all over the world and you meet all these people. And the fan base is so strong for Stargate still. And it's just so cool to see. And I don't know, it'd be a real fun thing, you know. But we'll all be kind of like, by the time they shoot it, we'll be rolling up, you know, just... Getting there, you know, Mikhail coming off to roll him in. He'll have a neck brace on or something. Ronan's going to be about 400 pounds. Do you know I wrestled him once? Guess who won? Beckett won. And then I choked Joe Flanagan out too, but he says he didn't, you know, didn't matter. You know, he said, Paul, you didn't choke me. I go, yes, I did, Joe. He got out because all this hair gel could have made him slippery.
The pride of Brock Badger's wrestling, from what
I understand. That's right. I was a university grappler.
There you go. The Scottish accent, relatively famous. You left Scotland at 2, went back in your early teens. Is that where you perfected the accent? Because you would have lost it in between, right?
Yes. My parents, I was born in Scotland, one of 7 kids. Came over when I was obviously quite young, but then when I was 12, they moved us back to Scotland until I was 15. My parents have a very, very thick Scottish accent. My mom doesn't think she has an accent. So because I tease her about her accent all the time, she will never call the home and leave a message on the phone anymore. And she's like, I'll call her up and go, hi, Mom, how you doing? She'll go, I'm not leaving a message. Your dad's doing it. I go, Mom, I go, you still have a it's just I've lost my accent. I don't have a Scottish accent anymore. I go, oh, yeah, all right. Fair enough.
I want to ask one more Scottish question, then we'll move it back to the North America. Your plaid, do you have a plaid? Does your family have a plaid?
The McGillion is the name is Irish, but the closest plaid we have is McAlpine, which my mom's maiden name is. And this is a funny Stargate story. We were at Edinburgh Castle. I was doing a signing at a comic book store there. Went to Edinburgh Castle. You know, it's really cool. And my mom said, when you get there, go to the Crown Jewels. And in the Crown Jewels, there's the one guard. He's in this little small room, and there's a little rope. You can't go over there. And I'm looking at it, but there's a sign. It's a lineage. And it has, the first king of Scotland is Kenneth McAlpine. So my mom's like, we're royalty. I'm like, thank you. So I go in there. I had to get a picture of this with my mom. And, you know, I go up there. Listen, can I, he goes, no one's allowed to go through there. And he's like, no one, are you Dr. Beckett? And I said, yes, I am, in the flesh. He goes, come out through. Come on through, mate. I'm like, thank you very much.
Is everyone okay with light Stargate Atlantis spoilers? I assume at this point you've seen the series, right? Okay. What is it? What process do you go through to play a clone of yourself? Is it 1 degree off? Is it
nothing? I said to them, I go, am I any different? No. So basically exactly the same? Yes. And how are you doing this again? And wait a minute, I died with an exploding tumor? Okay. Yeah. No, I mean, it was basically the same character. It was more the reaction of the other cast about me was the difference, because they were skeptical of me, you know, and stuff at first. And, you know, it certainly came back, and there was talk of, you know, obviously we went to season six, that the character that I think would probably be back in a bigger capacity as well. But, you know, as we know, that didn't happen. But you know what? 100 episodes of television in this day and age is pretty impressive. I mean, you look at Stargate, that's 17 seasons of Stargate. That's a lot of television, right? Yeah. That's 340 episodes total.
And what was the season six arc? Just lay it out, outline it for us real quick.
Beckett was trapped on a planet with Swedish models.
Nice. That sounds all right.
No Stargate to get out. Great storyline.
One of the things I've seen you mention is that you do audition coaching. So what is your advice? How do you coach an audition?
Well, you know, you get young actors that come in, you know, they want to, you know, sometimes they're older actors, you know, friends, peers. But, you know, basically they come in, they bring the sides that they call excerpts of the script, and they pull those out and they read them with me, and I kind of work with them to see if I can get them to hopefully make it better or improve it a little bit, you know. It's just like, you know, I have a teaching degree and just basically work with the actors and see, you know, see if you can, hopefully they can get the part, you know, just kind of work with them and, you know, try to be honest, and they'll hopefully they'll get the part. Some of them do. Some of them don't.
Once you heard J.J. Abrams is taking over Star Wars, how quickly did you text, put in a call to him to be in the Star Wars universe as well, now that you've been in Star Trek, Stargate?
Well, we were having dinner at the time when that happened. No, I'm kidding. Wouldn't that be cool? You know, it's very... I'll tell you a little story. You know, I did a little cameo in the Star Trek movie, you know, played... and I was... Thank you. Anyway, so we're at the movies... And I'd seen it down in L.A. I went to the cast and crew screening, you know, and J.J. was so great when I got the part. You know, I read for Scotty initially, and obviously went to Simon Pegg. And that was, you know, I totally get it, and that was cool. And after James Doohan's family, they kind of publicly endorsed me to play the part, and I still never met them. But that was really cool, and I went through the process, and I found I didn't get it. And I was like, ah, it's too bad. I mean, obviously, it would have been a great part to play. But I'm driving back up through Portland, Oregon, actually, and... just before that, in the mountains, and my manager calls and says, listen, J.J. Abrams' office called, and they want to offer you something in the Star Trek movie. I'm like, great, what is it? And they said, they won't tell you until you say yes. And I'm like, yes. So, you know, what are you going to say, no? Anyway, I got the part, and I came to the set, and I hadn't really met J.J., and the first AD, his name's Tommy, and he's a really great guy. He's thick Glaswegian Scottish accent, and he goes, hey, you're Paul McGillion. He goes, oh, good, for God's sakes, man. JJ, lovely. Fantastic job. Had Simon Pegg in mind a long time ago. This is great. Come and meet JJ. So I go meet JJ. We're in this gigantic hangar with all these blimps, where they build blimps in Southern California. And he comes up to me and goes, Paul, thank you so much for doing this. You know, I got to tell you, your fan base is crazy. Those guys love you, right? They're Stargate fans. Yeah, I said, yeah, they're great. Thanks for doing this. He goes, he's cool. Everything good? He goes, come and check out this spaceship. So, you know, I'm walking around with JJ Abrams going, shouldn't he be doing something else? He's like spending time with me. This is awesome. But he was such a cool guy, a class act. It was just like, you know, the excitement that he has and the ease. You know, it's nice to know that really cool people and obviously very bright people can succeed in the business and do really, really well. And he does a lot of cool stuff. So let's put it this way. Anytime they call, I'll you know, be honored to be on any project he does.
Wouldn't your fan base also take the credit for bringing you back on Stargate Atlantis?
I think they should, because I think they did, you know. I was down in Los Angeles. My brother called, and he goes, have you seen the news up here? I said, well, no, I'm down here. And he goes, there's a pipe band rally going on with your character in front of the Stargate in pouring rain. There's hundreds of people, Stargate fans, and all the girls are flashing their bums with, say, Carson Beckett on their underwear. I'm like, that's pretty cool, you know. That's pretty cool.
We are aware you have a newborn, Hugh.
Yes.
What has parenting taught you about life? Profound.
Wow. You can run on 2 hours of sleep a night. Honestly, it's so great. Little Hugh is my grandfather's name is Hugh, and it's just amazing. It's an amazing experience. He's like 6.5 months old. He's just a little sweetheart, and it's just really cool, you know. And he just makes you smile. I was shooting a movie. I went away, and I was away for about 7 days. It's the first time I've left him for more than a day. And I came back late at night, and so he was sleeping. And then he woke up in the morning like 6. My wife says, I'll go get him. You must be tired. I said, no, I want to see him. So I went in the room and put the light on. He's just looking up, and he has a big smile on his face, and he sees me. And his arms just start shaking like this. I'm like, oh, my God, he knows me. This is crazy. I am your dad. It's crazy. He looks like Jason Momoa, but I don't know what happened there. But at least he's going to be really, really good looking, so it's fine. He came out, he has dreadlocks.
I think I read on a forum he was named after David Hewlett, but
oh, God.
I don't know if that's true or not.
He was complaining in his crib.
What would the moment be where you're on the set of Stargate Atlantis and you thought, okay, this is officially bonkers, right here, right
bonkers?
Now. Bonkers. Cray bonk.
That would be when Jason, you know, who had a trailer right beside me, he has like an Airstream trailer, you know, those silver ones. We all had trailers, but he brought his own trailer, which looks like a museum. Yeah. It's got covered in skulls and heads and, you know, like just, I can't even tell you what it looks like, right? You know, so it's basically the set of The Walking Dead is in his trailer. And so he would sit there and he was learning how to play guitar at the time and I'd be in the trailer beside me and all you hear is like, bang, 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 bang. It's like Deliverance, right? I'm like, what are you doing? He goes, Paulie, did you get the script? I'm like, yeah, I got it. Let me see it. So he kind of just, you know, I give him the script and he'd basically eat it. And he's like turning the pages like this. He's like, all right, yeah. Okay, I'm going out for beers. Meanwhile, you know, Beckett and McKay have giant alien medical Scottish jargon, you know, to say, right? And I'm like, damn it. That's what happens when you kick ass. That's what he said to me. I'm like, yeah, I guess so. That's great. But then his little treat was, he goes, you know what I'm going to do? Guess what I did? I'm like, what? And he goes, I just hotboxed to Hewlett's trailer. I go, what'd you do? He goes, I turned all the water off and I took a big dump in his toilet and turned the heat up. He's going to be here in about a half hour. I'm like, what? Sure enough, David rolls in his little car, goes in the trailer. I was like, ow! That's when I knew it was bonkers.
I interviewed him last year, and I can tell you his process hasn't changed. The Conan script, yep, good, done.
Yeah, he's like Marmaduke meets Chewbacca.
Is this your first time to Emerald City Comic Con?
Yes, my first time, and you guys are awesome. Thank you. I love the Pacific Northwest.
We're gonna go through some rapid-fire stuff, then I'm going to turn it over to the audience, but one
Married.
Last... Too late. Yep. One last long form question. What's your average day look like these days? Like, are you reading scripts all the time? Are you taking care of Hugh? Are you going out to the market? What are you doing?
Mondays and Tuesdays, I take care of the baby full time. If I have auditions, you know, kind of work around that. And I have a couple buddies that come over, you know, and he has about five different uncles and aunts that kind of, you know, adopted him. And I just, you know, just auditioning and reading stuff and, yeah, going shopping, just regular stuff, you know, shopping, trying to take care of the baby, make sure he's still breathing. You know, my best I can. And the first time by yourself, I'm like, oh my God, what am I doing with him? But now I got a handle on it, I think. So that's pretty much it.
All right, lightning round. You ready?
Yeah, okay, lightning round. Okay.
Granville Island Market versus Pike Place Market. Controversial. Yeah. He's supposed to just say one. It was supposed to be lightning. Yeah.
Pike, because Granville Island's super overpriced.
Okay. The Space Needle versus whatever you call that Toronto Needle thing. I don't know what it's called. Sorry.
Space Needle.
You know your crowd. Yeah. Your
Sonics.
your go-to karaoke song.
Oh, Can't Help Falling in Love, Elvis. Hello, ladies.
Favorite pizza topping.
Banana peppers.
Wow, controversial.
And sausage and pepperonis and everything. Mushrooms.
Hobbies.
What?
Go. Your hobbies, what do you do besides
nothing?
That's it. Yeah. Okay, fair go.
Yeah.
Amount of episodes you watched of Stargate Atlantis actually on television?
Three. No. God, I don't know. On television?
Yeah. I know you were there for
For sure, over half. You know what I mean? Definitely. I mean, I've watched them in some capacities, like in the, you know, the edit room, but yeah, definitely. I'd say maybe three quarters.
That's pretty good. Even the ones you weren't on?
No.
Okay, fair.
What the hell would I watch that for?
Book you're reading or book you'd want to recommend to people?
World According to Garp. Love it.
TV shows you're currently watching or enjoying?
Currently watching right now. Sorry, it should be rapid. The Bachelor. My wife watches The Bachelor all the time, so I have to watch it. It's so intriguing. It's like a train wreck.
Some of those women are not there for the right reasons, I maintain.
Exactly.
Yeah. A movie you'd like to recommend or favorite movie, either one.
True Romance.
Nice.
Love it.
Quentin Tarantino stuff. Yeah. All right, now let's turn it over to the audience.
Whoa, hello.
Oh. BSG.
It's the chief from Battlestar Galactica.
I guess we're open for...
I've got a wee question, if you don't mind.
Sure, yeah.
Oh, no, can I use one of
these? I hope, if it's on.
Oh, hello.
Hello, cheeky.
Yeah, cheeky bugger. Hey, everybody, how you doing?
Aaron Douglas.
I'm not here this weekend.
He's a clone.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I am a Cylon. For years now, Paulie and I are old friends, and I love him like a brother. And for years now, I have been going around the world telling my favorite Paul McGillion story. And it's wonderful for me because I get a huge laugh because it's so great, and I tell it better than he does. but it's sort of going back to your parents and a little bit of the Scottish brogue. For those of you who haven't heard this story, I would like Paulie to tell it. I'm not going to do it. But my favorite part about this is whenever Paulie would show up at a country after me, he'd go, has anybody heard this story? And they'd go, Aaron Douglas was here earlier. He told us this story.
He steals my material.
But it's so genius. Yeah. So I'm going to step off. Thank you very much, everybody. Paulie is doing a little charity thing at the end, and you're not going to be able to see this, but this is a picture of Paulie and I probably from, oh, I don't know. This is... What is that, 2006?
I think Dragon Con, maybe 2006.
2006, something
probably
like that.
Probably day four, because we both look really hungover.
Yeah. It's both of our thinner, younger brothers. This is the only one. Froggy, I think Froggy took this picture, and then he printed it out for me. I am wearing white linen pants, and he's wearing, I don't know, slacks from The Gap?
Yeah.
So we're... That I know for a fact this is really old because that shirt doesn't fit me anymore, and I still have my earring in. So, yeah, I was badass.
Definitely not Seattle hipsters in that picture.
No, absolutely. So let's add that to the charity auction.
And Aaron's going
to
sign it for you, too. So I'll do a charity auction later for Children's Hospital. Yeah.
And I'll write all kinds of stuff on that. But right now I'm going to take off and give it back to you guys. And please tell your story.
I will tell the story. Aaron Douglas, everybody.
Thank you, Chief.
Love you, buddy.
That guy had a plan.
He's good. This guy's good. He knows how to roll. Where's Claire? Is Claire in here? Claire. Oh, she... Yeah. God, you're annoying. No, I'm just kidding. Just bring that stuff up here. She's got some... I'm going to charity auction some scripts I have from Atlantis, my own scripts, and some sides and call sheets, a couple of really cool items that you guys might be interested in, which is, you know, pretty like one-of-a-kind things. But the story he's talking about, I'll tell it briefly. I'm the only actor in the family. There's seven kids. And when I started acting, my dad was like, I went to teacher's college. I did a teaching degree. He's like, you're a teacher. Teach for Christ's sakes. You're not acting. What kind of game you're playing with the acting? I said, Dad, it's what I want to do. And he's like, oh, for God's sakes, here we go. So I moved to Vancouver from Toronto, and I start acting. I got a part on a show called The X-Files, right? And my dad like calls up, and he goes, answer the phone. Hello. I go, hey, Dad, it's Paul. Janet, it's Paul on the phone. How's it going, man? I said, any gigs? He's got the acting terminology. I said, actually, Dad, yeah, I got a job on the X-Files. X-Files? That's a popular show. I said, yes, it is. And he goes, how much did you make? And I told him, he goes, that's bloody fantastic, the acting. Great stuff, man. Our son, the actor. Here's your mom, right? So years go by, I call him, and every time he answers the phone, I'm like, Dad, how you doing? Great, man. Any gigs? I told him, I said, I just got in Stargate. Yes, I did. Janet, Paul got a gig. Fantastic. What is it? And I told him, I said, it's, I'm playing a doctor. You're a doctor? Janet is a doctor? We have a doctor in the house. And I go, Dad, it's better. What? Scottish doctor. Scottish doctor? Janet, Scottish? Oh, my God, a Scottish doctor. Great. What is it? I go, Stargate. What? Stargate. What? Stargate. Star Trek. No, Stargate. Star Trek. Stargate. Star Trek. I said, no, Stargate. Stargate Atlantis. It's not bloody Stargate. Star Trek. I've been watching it for years. I go, Dad, it's. I'm the one doing it. Don't raise your voice, you old man. Here's your mom, Janet. Paul's on the Star Trek. She comes on the phone. Are you on the Star Trek? Yes. Yes, I am. True story. They'll be married 60 years, April 11th.
Okay, you've been waiting very patiently. Step up to the mic and deliver.
Hey, Paul.
Hello, sexy.
So, in honor of Wee Carson, what was Carson Beckett's favorite toy as a child?
Favorite what?
Toy.
Rodney? Not like that.
Too late.
Very cute.
At what moment did you know you wanted to act as a career?
Well, when I was born, my mom all said I came out. I was born in Scotland, and she goes, I was born in the house because the ambulance didn't come in time or whatever. And I was actually born in the bed, but I always tell people, I'm like, Mom, it's more dramatic if I say I was born on the kitchen table. You weren't born on the kitchen table. Don't tell. But when I was born, can you guys hear me? Yeah? He had, is this mic working? Yeah. When I was born, I had a huge head of curly hair, which is kind of weird. And I came out, my mom's like, oh, for God's sakes. Look at his head. It looks like a wee beetle. Let's call him Paul. That's how I got my name. And she goes, oh, you're an actor the moment you came out. And, but, you know, I think a big family of seven kids who grew up. But I actually, you know, didn't really get into acting until I was almost 20. You know, so about four or five years ago.
I have a quick follow-up to that. Yes. Your origin story in terms of acting, so you didn't have your degree in teaching at that point when you started trying out for things and getting booked, or you did?
I was in school at the same time when I started doing stuff. So I did a lot of TV commercials, did a lot of theaters.
Tic Tac, I read.
Pardon me?
Tic Tac commercial?
I did a Tic Tac commercial, yep.
You crushed that.
U.S. National, yeah, that was a good one.
So your first official acting job was?
A music video with David Wilcox, which is a Canadian artist. And they had me playing kind of like the brooding boyfriend, and they had this model, it was my girlfriend, and she's about 6'5", so they had to put me on an apple box the whole time. And I was supposed to be chasing around the car, but it looked like this midget that was chasing around the car. You know, I was crazy, right? I was like tiny, and she was like this woman, and it was giant. So, yeah.
I think that's Tom Cruise's story, too. So
probably, yeah. Person.
All right, go ahead.
In the movie A Dog's Breakfast, I want to... I was wondering, how was it for you to come on set in drag, and how did the rest of the crew end?
Wonderful. the rest of the crew, yeah, David Hewlett, he gets me to come into a movie and dress in drag. Weird. I gotta tell you, ladies, after shaving the legs and putting the heels and putting the bra and everything on, huge, huge respect. I don't know if you haven't seen this movie. It's a movie David Hewlett wrote and directed and starred in, and, you know, he did a great job, and him and his wife produced it, and I got to play like three different characters, and one of them, we're trying to find a voice for this character, was Detective Morris. And I said, you know, I was going to do a New York accent. I said, why is she like Scottish? He's like, that's perfect. You know, for the Stargate fans, I thought that would be a nice homage. So David is kind of naked in the movie at one point
kind
in time.
Kind of naked.
And I chase him out the door, and he falls out the window in the movie, and he's lying in on the yard, and it's pouring rain in Vancouver. He's lying on his stomach, naked, with soap suds on his bum. I'm standing above him in drag, with an umbrella waiting for him to say action. And then I look at David, and the camera, they're like, oh, the battery ran out. I'm like, oh, God. He can't get up, so I have to hold an umbrella over him so the soap suds don't dissipate and show off his butt, you know, more. So I look, I'm holding this thing over his bum while the girl's getting, like, soap suds and putting more soap suds on David's butt, right? To build it up a bit. And I'm looking at him, I go, this better be funny. He's like looking at me, he's like, yeah, and then my heels just sink into the mud, right? So yeah, the drag thing, that was kind of weird. I actually, at first when they started doing it, I thought I looked kind of hot, but then after I get everything on, I look like a linebacker. I was like, didn't look good. Thank you.
Do you have any plans to write or direct in the future Pauly world?
You know, I produce quite a few short films and a couple feature films, and I'd like to direct at some point in time. I directed some theater and stuff, but not in the immediate future. I'm kind of just focused on acting right now, but definitely directing down the line.
Go ahead.
My question was actually along the same lines of that. I was basically just hunting for an embarrassing story about you and David. But are there any plans to do anything like that with any of the other Stargate people, or do you have anything else upcoming?
You know, not right. You know, I'd love to at some point in time. I love those guys. You know, and to see them. You know, oftentimes I, you know, we'll see each other at cons. That's kind of like how we see each other now, but I keep in touch with everybody. But I would definitely love to work with them again in some capacity, but nothing's really in the works at this point in time. But it would be cool.
I saw you, I think, tweeted Jewel State today. Has Twitter been like a good way for you to connect with your Stargate Atlantis?
I am technically inept, and Jewel got me onto Twitter, you know, and I just got on it, and it's pretty cool. It's like Pauly McGillion, at Pauly McGillion with a Y. And if you would like to follow me on Twitter, that'd be cool. It's really interesting to get to see what's going on and happening. I'm not on Facebook or anything like that. So, you know, until like about 2 months ago, I had a flip phone. So, yeah. I'm pretty old school. So it's been pretty cool.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Shelley.
Hi, Shelley.
I just have two things. What do you think is like the funniest, like strange, weird, you just thought it was hilarious moment that you've had for any of your roles or?
Sorry, what was it again?
What do you think is like the funniest thing you've ever done, like as a role, or just like a funny event that's happened while you're like shooting or something? Like that?
Well, the funniest things that ever happened while we're shooting or something. I'll make it a Stargate one. This is pretty funny. Joe Flanagan did it to me. I have not gotten him back yet, but we did an episode where Joe and myself and David and I are carrying this. I think it's Phantoms, and we're carrying the stretcher with the big soldiers on it. But it's in a village, so the handles on the thing are wood, and they're really wide, so you can't get your fingers around them. And Joe purposely puts like the biggest guy in the stretcher that David and I have to, you know. So David immediately has a blister on his finger, right? He's crying, and like the whole time we're doing this, and I'm sweating, and David's sweating because Beckett also had a backpack and everything with his medical. So what Joe's doing in between every take is he's taking my backpack and filling it up with rocks. So by like take 8, we're going up this hill. I am pouring sweat, and Joe's like, "Paul, you're really working up a sweat there, buddy." I'm like, "Yeah, it's hot out, man." And this guy weighs 350 pounds that you put on the stretcher, and we can't change it because we've already got the master shot done. And he's like, "Yeah, anyway, I'm heading home, buddy. I'll talk to you soon." So and he goes, he left a little note for the props guy to hand to me at the end of the day, and he goes, "Just hand this to Paul." It's like, "Open up your backpack, love, Joe." So at the end of it, I open my backpack up, and there's like boulders in my backpack. I'm gonna get that bastard back. I swear to God.
And what was your second?
The other thing, really quick. My friend Rochelle couldn't come here, and she's a huge Stargate Atlantis.
I'm married.
I just was wondering if you would be willing to like let me take a video of you saying hi to her.
No.
And her.
Yes, of course.
Okay.
You better be ready now.
Can you do it right now?
In
yeah.
Three,
ready?
Two.
Hello, Michelle, you sexy, sexy, naughty little thing.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi, I'm Wilgren.
Hi.
I had a question about when you were in Sanctuary. What was it like to play with Amanda Tapping as the role that she was when you were in Abnormal?
Very, very cool to work on Sanctuary. You know, a lot of Stargate people kind of, you know, asked me to come over and do that role. And, you know, basically, you know, he's the complete opposite of Beckett. You know what I mean? He's just an anal, sort of like a David Hewlett anal sort of lizard. That's really angry, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was really great to work with Amanda. She's always a pleasure to work with. And it was kind of cool to play that character, you know. The contacts and, you know, like you're blue right now, which is very attractive, don't get me wrong. the makeup took about maybe 4 hours. So, you know, you're in there for quite a while in the chair, and then you have these contacts, so you can't see. So everything has to be memorized completely, because if you're like, oh, God, I forgot my line or something like that, you can't read your sides because you have green contacts on and I can't see them, right? So it was a little challenging in that sense, but it was a cool character. You know, I kind of liked him. It's good to be the villain like that.
Was it kind of cool with the whole, I don't know if it's like a dinosaur style with the piece that came off when you got really angry?
Yes, and the gills come out and stuff like that. Yeah, that was pretty cool.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
I think you played a villain in Shattered as well. Do you like playing bad dudes after being such a good dude?
Yeah, I mean, I like to mix it up a little bit. You know, I love comedy, I love drama, but if you get a play, like, I think I played like a kind of a weird kind of serial killer in that. But, you know, that's always kind of fun to do, you know, to play a different kind of character, you know what I mean? But, it's kind of fun to play the villain sometimes, but, you know, it's also fun to play the nice guy.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So I'm following you on Twitter, and it's great that you're on Twitter. What finally got you onto Twitter? Because I know Jewel was kind of like...
Jewel actually sat when we were having a glass of wine, and she did it.
That sounds about right.
I'm like, do this. I'm like, just give me your phone. And she set it completely up for me.
You, Jewel,
yeah, I told you, I'm terrible. Pardon me?
You, Jewel, and Michael arguing is hysterical.
Yeah, she's great, and you know, and Michael and I, Shanks, and well, we're doing a panel together, myself, him, and Alexa tomorrow, so that'll be kind of cool. Yeah. You know they're married, right?
There's always polygamy.
It's really weird. I think she has a crush on me, but don't tell him.
Who had the Paul? Who had Paul McGillion your name already? Like, why do you have to go Pauly?
I have no idea. All my friends call me Pauly, so I don't know.
Okay.
Maybe it was a mistake, right? I should have put, just put Paul. I don't have no idea. Yes.
Was there any things in the past that you've auditioned for that you wish you would have gotten?
Yeah, thanks a lot. I don't know, maybe Scotty? Yeah, I mean, there's a few. There's also a few things that you kind of wish you would have gotten, you know, sometimes, and that you read for. But, you know, part of the acting business is it's a business that's oftentimes based on rejection, you know? So, I mean, going into it, you just do your best, and you're going to get some, and sometimes you're not, and you can't take it personally. So you just go and you give it a kick at the can, and it's all about an essence. If they want to hire me, they're going to hire me. If they want to hire, you know, somebody else, they're going to hire them, and it's got nothing to do with me. But, yeah, there's a few parts, but I've had some really good opportunities and successes too, so I look more to those. I'm a half empty, half full guy rather than half empty, you know what I mean?
What's the batting average of an actor? Do you get 1 out of 5 parts? Do you get...
Well, listen to this. There's less than 5% of the actors that are in the union, okay, less than 5 in the union, so there's way more actors that are not in the union because you need a certain amount of credits. Less than 5% make over the poverty level, actors. So it's the kind of, they say if you can get 1 out of 20 auditions, you're doing okay. So can you imagine having 20 job interviews and you might get one? Like, you know, on a regular basis, you know, that's why I watch things like American Idol and stuff, and, you know, people are like, go and have an audition, they're bawling because they don't get in. I'm like, really? You know, I mean, but, you know, that's part of the business, and you have to know that going into it, and a lot of people don't, and that can be really detrimental to you, like, mentally, you know, and that's why they say that term, you know, the business can eat you alive, and that's where that term comes from, because it can if you let it, but if you don't, you know, if you know what the beast is, you can slay it, you know? So just do your best.
Go ahead.
Going off of that, are we going to see any more of you on Once Upon a Time?
That would be cool. You know, I play the Knave of Hearts, you know. Yeah, speaking of drag, yeah, that's a pretty quirky character. That's fun, yeah. I mean, if they call, I'll come back on the show. So you never know. I mean, I think, you know, Wonderland's always out there. So we'll see what happens. Go ahead, you're a handsome devil.
It's great to see you, as always.
You too. This is a gentleman right here.
I believe Dog's Breakfast was actually a broadcast TV. Is that correct?
I think it might have been, yeah.
So does that mean bigger residuals, that you can actually make the sequel, The Dog's...
You know, that's a question for the Hewletts, you know, because he's the one making it. But it'd be cool to do it again, you know.
I was very pleased to see that. But you seem to have drawn, like, one of the better sci-fi kind of films in Gretel Witch Slayer. What was it like to work with Amelia?
Oh, are you kidding me?
Now, compared to what Shanks is in, you're he's a megastar. I have a copy of Mega Snake right there I paid $4 for.
If you haven't seen this yet, it was nominated for an Oscar. It's called Gretel Witch Slayer. It's myself as Hansel growing up, before the Jeremy Renner one, and Shannon Doherty is Gretel. And Mario Azzopardi, who directed a bunch of Stargate episodes, directed it. We shot it in Toronto. And there's part of it where there's this giant gargoyle, you know, in a scene. And, you know, I'm fighting it because I'm, like, you know, kind of a tough, brooding, you know, witch slayer. And there's a scene where you know, I'm fighting this imaginary gargoyle. And it's one of the crew guys who has a little sign with a picture of a clown face. And he's walking around with this. So I'm pretending I'm fighting it. And I have the thing. And I'm like, and it's 100 degrees. I have a sword and everything. I'm wearing leather pants, you know. They look pretty hot, actually. And then so then basically I'm jumping, and Mario Azzopardi is this big, you know, Maltese guy. He's like, okay, chief, okay. The gargoyle is there. You're fighting the gargoyle, chief. You're diving, you're rolling, you're jumping. I am pouring sweat doing all this stuff, you know. And I'm like, okay, dive. The gargoyle is coming for you. You're scared, you're fighting. This goes on for 5 minutes, right? I'm like, you know, I'm exhausted, you know. I finish it, and he goes, and then I see this guy come over to him and talk to him. And Mario goes, okay, chief, here's the thing. The gargoyle is not that big. It's small, Chief. It's a small gargoyle. It's only 10 feet tall. The first take, I'm doing it. I'm fighting. I think it's like 40 feet tall. So when you watch the movie, sometimes I'm fighting the gargoyle, and I'm like this. And then sometimes I'm fighting, and I'm like this, you know? So, I mean, it was fun to do. But, you know, those sci-fi movies, they're, you know, you kind of do your best with them. Sometimes I wish it was a comedy.
Thanks so much.
You're welcome. Nice to see you.
Hi.
Hi.
What was your very first audition like?
I can't remember. it was definitely something in Toronto, I think. Oh, actually, it was a show called Street Legal, and I played like a reoccurring part as a bartender on it. But it was, you know, I was kind of nervous. But I did lots of commercials and stuff like that before, you know what I mean, and student films and stuff like that. So it kind of eased you into reading for television a little bit more in film.
Mm-hmm. And also, what do you think would be the most embarrassing audition experience that you've had?
Oh, my God. There's tons of them. let me see. I remember reading for the Greg Louganis story. Years ago, it was a movie of the week, and, you know, I was like, you know, maybe it was quite a while ago, maybe 15, 17 years ago, and, you know, Paulie had was a little fitter at the time, and all of the guys had to go in bathing suits, Speedos, because he was a swimmer, and had to sing a happy birthday song, and I'm like, this is so embarrassing, and, you know, I did it, but I didn't get the part, you know. But I just thought, like, all these guys in the waiting room were going in our bathing suits, reading to this casting director, you know, who's sitting there. And he's like, okay, next. So that wasn't, you know, my finest moment.
I think you. Mario Lopez got that part, didn't he?
Yeah. Momoa got it.
Quick aside about acting, actually. Have you worked with method actors? Or, I mean, how do you feel about method acting in general? Is it annoying? Or method acting?
I mean, to each his own. You know, I have worked with people that kind of go that way. I personally don't, but, you know, which works for me. But if someone needs to do that, you know, for obviously the process, I mean, you know, I know Daniel Day-Lewis is he's very method, and I think that works for him. You know, I mean, the guy's amazing. But it's just to each his own, whatever process you have, you know. But it's very funny because we have Robert Davi, you know, him. He played Kolya. He was on the show, but I don't think he ever watched any episodes. So he never knew my character was Scottish. So I met him a bunch of times, but we hadn't had any direct scenes together. Then we have a scene, I'm in behind a prison bars and stuff like that, and he comes over, he's a big guy, he's talking like this, and he's like, we start doing the scene, and I'm like, you gonna let us out here? And he was just like, you know, taken back. He's like, are you gonna talk like that? I'm like, that's right, hot shot, that's the way Beckett talks. And he's like, get out of here. I go, that's right, Mr. Fancy Pants. And he was just like, oh, my God. So it was just kind of funny, you know, that you can throw that in and mix it up a little bit. So that was kind of fun.
Go ahead.
If your character from Once Upon a Time had ended up in Storybrooke, what do you think he'd have to do since Cora wouldn't be his boss?
He'd definitely be a minion of some sort. I think he would have, you know, that something like that for sure. You know what I mean? Like in a little tight suit or something. You know what I mean? That kind of thing. Like, you know, the Devil Wears Prada kind of thing.
Do you think growing up in a household with so many siblings made you a person who, like, a better actor as you sought, like, the spotlight kind of thing? Because you had to stand out amongst your
siblings. Well, I got beat up a lot.
Yeah. Same, yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think it did. I mean, it built character. I think when you live in a family, you know, that big, you know, you got to, you know, my mom would call for, you know, dinner to be ready, and then there'd be, like, a storm up the stairs, and then my dad would be like, stop bloody run, you know, and then I'd be back, and we'd all take our dinners and go downstairs and hang out, and I mean, Christmases are also a big, you know, a laugh, and my family is very gregarious and a lot of very strong personalities, very different. So I think it actually, you know, I think that's the thing about acting. You know, real life, the more you can bring yourself to a part, I think the more believable it is. You know, so I think every role is an extension of yourself to a certain degree. You know,
hopefully not the serial killer one as
much. Not the serial killer. No.
Go ahead.
That was some crazy guy.
First, thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Now, I can't specifically remember the name of the episode. There's an episode of Atlantis where you and Joe Flanagan get trapped on a planet with four Stargate members who are all female. You recall
Whispers.
Michael.
Whispers.
Whispers, yes.
Awesome episode.
How'd that turn out for Beckett?
Pardon me?
Ed did, after the episode had ended and you went back to Atlantis, did it turn out the way you wanted it to?
No. Beckett never got any. Like, how come Beckett can't get a girlfriend? They either die or something, or they turn out to be Rodney and he kisses me. Lips like sandpaper, my friends. I have one word for that. Halitosis. Yeah, trust me. That's what I felt. That's an episode called Duet and David Hewlett. And it was very funny because the morning of the kiss, you know, David, he's walking around set and all the crew guys are big dudes and stuff like that. They're like, I smell some romance in the air. I'm like, shut up, you know. But in the rehearsal, David, you know, he caught me. In the rehearsal, normally you don't go full speed in the rehearsal, but David just kind of grabs me and plants me right in the mouth, you know? And he goes, just had to get that over with. I'm like, thanks. Creepy. I have a restraining order against him.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Meg.
Hello.
And I was wondering if you could do any role or any type of role, what would it be?
Bond, Polly Bond.
Thank you.
And not the denture thing. That'd be fun.
Why do you think?
How much time roughly?
Maybe 15 minutes.
Okay, so give me 5 more minutes because I chaired a couple of auction things. So let me know.
You do you. Why are you cast as a doctor so often? Why do you think that is? Do you just have a presence about you, a doctoral?
I'm super caring. I have no idea, but oftentimes I think, you know, like Gillian Anderson's here, and she's like, unfortunately, you can, basically, if you can handle a lot of dialogue that's like, you know, alien, you know, obviously medical jargon, it's pretty tricky actually to do it. And if you can do it in television, you have to do it quickly and get it over with, because they don't have a lot of time to wait around for you to mess up your lines. So, I mean, I can do that. Sometimes you're kind of like, oh God, just give me something easy to say, you know what I mean? But that's probably why a little bit, you know. And, yeah, I think there's, a quality I think possibly I can bring to it where, you know, there's a believability that I'm actually nice. I think a lot of doctor roles have that kind of thing. But
bedside manner kind of thing.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
You're also an actor's actor in the sense that you can come into a show, fill a need, you know, quickly. How do you get yourself comfortable with a cast that you're not as familiar with, you know, and you're there for a week or a day or?
Yeah, no, that's a tricky thing for actors. You know, I really felt bad for a lot of the actors that came onto our show because, you know, especially like season 5, they're, you know, you're so established, and then someone comes on and it's a nervous feeling. You know, I have a lot of friends who are like, oh my God, my buddy's hilarious. He should be an actor. I'm like, I've seen a lot of very, very funny people that, you know, I think they're hilarious. But all of a sudden, you take that person, you give him some lines. You put him in front of 65 people he doesn't know and put a camera on him. Let's see how funny he is now. And it doesn't often work like that, you know. But I think the thing about being that's if, you know, if I was directing and were for produce films, I think making people feel comfortable and welcomed, you know, I think it leads to a good performance. You know, I think it just makes them feel happy and they're being validated. Some sets are like that. Some sets aren't. They come in sets and sometimes the leads, you know, they're doing whatever and they're kind of jaded and they don't even look at you. But you just got to be confident and just do your job. Hit the marks and do it and just know that, you know what you're doing.
Have there been times, and you obviously don't have to name names or shows, but you thought, well, that guy's the worst, like, where you had a bad experience?
Yes.
Are there directors out there you'd still like to work with, like, who, if they called right now, you'd leave the stage and run?
Oh, my God, yeah. Well, obviously, like, you know, Scorsese, or, you know, that would be pretty cool. Woody Allen, you know. Obviously, like, you know, love to work with JJ again. You know, that'd be awesome. Yeah, there's lots of directors out there. Like, you know, I like to experience, you know, Paul Thomas Anderson, you know. Cool.
Go ahead.
Hi.
Kind of.
So short.
Just scream it. I can hear you.
Okay. I was wondering, hi, but I was wondering why you were so orange in the dog's breakfast.
Why am I so orange?
Why you were so orange in the dog's breakfast.
Orange. Yes. Oh, because, because they ate a lot of oranges? No. Because the character was like a sci-fi soap opera actor, you know, so he basically would fake and bake all the time, you know, and that's, my hair was kind of like, they had me highlighted with like little white tips and stuff. Basically a guy that lives in a sunbed. And oftentimes they're orange.
Yeah. you compared sci-fi, especially, you know, Battlestar, Stargate Atlantis. There's a lot more comedy, but they're also kind of the new Westerns. Could you expound upon that theory a little bit? Have they replaced Westerns in our culture, sci-fi shows?
I don't know. I mean, you know, I think, obviously Serenity had a little bit of that, the kind of a Western sci-fi feel, you know, that would be really cool to have that again. I think Westerns are, I don't think they'll ever go away, you know, but the combination of those two things would be very, very interesting to see, again, like in a series. And I have a friend that's talking about something very similar to that, actually. So that'd be kind of cool if that worked out.
But you would say sci-fi has transformed since, you know, from the 60s where it was really campy to now, I mean, especially with your show, there was a lot of comedy, but there was also a lot of heart to it.
Yep.
So it was a more serious show, basically.
Yeah, I mean, you get the shows like ours. I think I kind of equate ours very similarly to, you know, the original Star Trek. It had that kind of feel, I think. You know, I think the cool thing about Stargate Atlantis and Stargate, you know, SG-1 especially, families can watch it together, you know, which is really sweet. You know, that you get to watch a show, and I've had so many families that have come up to me and said, you know, this is one thing we, in this day and age, you know, half the time you look at the kids, they're like, you know, playing their gadgets, and no one's actually ever talks, but they watch a show together sometimes, which is really kind of nice, you know. And then you get, you know, the darker shows a little bit, like you get into the Battlestar Galactica and Universe a little bit, where it's a bit more brooding, you know. I thought the best time for our show was on Sci-Fi Fridays when they had, you know, Stargate Atlantis, Stargate SG-1, Stargate Atlantis, and then Battlestar Galactica. And a lot of them, they'd watch the first two shows with their kids. The kids would go to bed, they'd watch Battlestar, you know, because it was a little bit, you know, maybe not for the little ones so much. So I thought that was a really cool thing. And then they switched it up a little bit, and I think that was, you know, that was a really smart move on the network's part to keep that. And then when it lost it, I think it bode that well, you know.
At what age will you be indoctrinating Hugh into the Stargate universe? Will it be like 2, or is it now, or is it?
No, the Wraith are too scary. I'm scared of the Wraith. But he was in his first movie at 3 months.
Wow. What was his role?
A little short. He was the baby in a crib.
He was an attorney.
My friend's movie.
We'll do a rapid fire to get you out of here as well. Do you have a hockey team as a Canadian, or?
Yes.
You're Scottish, but I mean.
No, I'm Canadian. Yeah, Montreal Canadiens.
Okay, very good.
Although I'm watching the hockey game tonight, Vancouver against Los Angeles Kings, Aaron Douglas against Will Wheaton, and we're watching that today, and they're like, Will's a huge LA Kings fan, Aaron's a huge Vancouver fan, so it's going to be very interesting to watch that.
You've mentioned your pizza topping, but your favorite overall meal? Last meal, go.
I got to say, you know, I had a big 16-ounce peppercorn New York steak.
Your favorite Stargate Atlantis episode?
I'd say for me, Poisoning the Well, because I think that was the episode that kind of made Beckett a regular, and it was really sad. But I also liked Irresistible, because Lucia, I thought that was funny, because all the characters came out a little bit different, you know what I mean? It was kind of funny. It's a funny episode.
Your favorite city to live in the world?
Vancouver. That's where I live. Seattle's a very close second.
Know your audience. Your favorite is, are the Beatles your favorite band? Is that accurate? I did a little research.
No.
Okay. Well,
but I like the Beatles. I like the Beatles. I mean, I'm a huge Rolling Stones fan for years. Have been. Yeah.
Your favorite way you've died in a show?
Definitely not the exploding tumor.
That was the worst.
Oh, yeah. No, I did a really bad horror movie called The Traveler with Val Kilmer. It's on Netflix.
How did you expire in that
one? I think I swear about 300 times in it. And I think he ripped my eyes out and my teeth.
Very good.
Well, that was awesome.
It happens. It's just life, right? Thank you so much for your time, Paul. We really appreciate it. And
can I do a little bit of that charity auction stuff?
I need to see what they're...
What's... What, we're done in 1 minute?
Yeah, 1 minute.
Are you guys going to come to the panel tomorrow with Lexa and Michael and myself? Okay.
What time is the panel? Do you remember?
I don't know. I think it's noon. I'll do the charity stuff then.
Okay.
If that's cool. It's for Children's Hospital. I can only do cash for it, but I have some scripts from Stargate Atlantis. I'll sign them. I'll get Michael and Alexa to sign them too. So if you guys are interested in doing that, I got a few items, that picture with Aaron and I. And I got to say from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much for having me here. The guys that run the convention, you know, Jim and George and all the staff and everybody, thank you so much. It's just run really, really well. And it's so nice to see so many happy people, you know, having a good time. I know there's big lineups out there, but, you know, we're really happy to see you guys when you come and say hi to us at the tables and stuff like that. So if you haven't popped by, I'll be signing tomorrow. I'll come by and say hi. And really thank you for welcoming me to Seattle. You guys have a great weekend, a safe weekend, okay? Thank you. that.
Thank you.
No. No. Had a cat before, but it passed away. Yeah, I love cat. I love cats. Yeah, I know. Perfect. Joe Malazzi. I think it was sort of an homage to the dog breakfast, I think a little bit, yeah. I think Martin Girl. Yes, give him that. Oh my god, thanks for having me. Oh my god, you're welcome, you guys. Good to see you guys. Thank you. Okay. Love that book. I was a wrestler. John Irving. No, have you? Nice. No? Yeah, you know they all say, guys.